this is Lee back once again for another video. It's been a while, but I've been busy with other things. Anyway, I'm back to do hopefully a shorter review of Shimmer, volume 68. Not so recently released, about the time that I was doing my last video, as it was a new release, but fairly recent. Now, this was, of course, one of the shows I attended live, and it was the second show of that Saturday evening, of course, following 67. Let me show you the wonderful artwork there. Tomoka Nakagawa and Kelly Skater, the Global Green Gangsters, and of course, the other artwork with Jessica Havoc, of course, my replacement disc here, and Vanessa Craven. This was a good matchup between the two of them. Yes. And of course, the usual, you know, back artwork. There we have, of course, EV and Mia Yim. I'm just going to go through the matches. I would say overall, this show impressed me much more than Volume 67. Although 67 was a very good show, with the standout matches, of course, being the standout matches being, of course, that match between Akino Tsukasa Fujimoto and Kiyori Yoniyama, the Joshi team, versus Tomoka Nakagawa and Kelly Skater, Global Green Gangsters and Mia Yim. That was an amazing match. Cheerleader Melissa versus Kana was great. And of course, Madison Eagles versus Nicole Matthews. But the first several matches, actually the ones that I missed at the live show, were actually not as of the usual quality of Shimmer. Now, I heard that, of course, the reason for that had something to do with usually these would have been sparkle matches. They were sort of bumped up in the card to become actual matches. Whether that's true or not, and of course, you know, these wrestlers tried their best, I'm sure, and it was better than a lot of the women's wrestling you see on television. It just nevertheless was not as good as some of the later matches, and certainly not as good as the matches on here. So, just to go through the matches on volume 68, we start out with Thunder Kitty versus Cherry Bomb, and this was more of a comedic match. Cherry Bomb would later, of course, become injured, but at this time, you know, she's still doing, you know, what she normally does, which is be shrill and annoying and full of herself, but nevertheless a talented wrestler. Thunder Kitty, with her limited, deliberately limited move set, kind of her no-nonsense, well, a lot of nonsense. She doesn't put up with nonsense from others, let's put it that way. And she points out that, you know, she has a cherry tattoo, and of course, Cherry Bomb, of course, has her cherry armband. So it's kind of a comedic match. Very often, the early Shimmer matches will be sort of comedic focused, or they'll take maybe some of the less experienced wrestlers who are maybe cute and kind of start things off that way. So that I think that served its purpose, kind of warming things up. Moving on, Solo Darling versus Marty Bell. Now, of course, I had not seen much of Marty Bell at that time. Of course, her gimmick was with the hairspray, much like Azima Ion in TNA. Of course, before he became DJZ later on. Very vain. But, you know, these two wrestlers, you know, fairly green, as they say, but a decent match. Basically, Solo Darling starting to come to her own as a serious competitor, despite her kind of goofy, you know, candy corn colored fox animal outfit. Kind of an amusing match, and there was some witty banter back and forth. Then we had Xandra Bale versus Miss Natural. Unfortunately, the crowd was absolutely dead for this match. There was very little involvement with the crowd, despite it being a classic, you know, David and Goliath. Miss Natural, of course, mean, nasty person, much larger than Xandra Bale. Xandra Bale, you know, putting up her best fight, but just not not really winning much sympathy from the crowd at all. So I felt bad for the the two of them that they didn't get more. I think there's a couple of chops in the corner, and of course they always have to do the Ric Flair woo. But apart from that, not a lot of crowd enthusiasm, unfortunately. So I guess they were tired. Now some of these matches I think are out of order, and I'll say more about that in a bit. Next, we have Kimberly and Kaylee Ray. Now, Kimberly is actually a very talented wrestler. I give her a lot of credit. She plays kind of this snobbish character, you know, before her team up with Cherry Bomb and the Spoilers, they become champions for a bit there. But at this time, Kimberly doing what she does best, which is to annoy the fans, and is a decent wrestler. Very good. Kaylee Ray, of course, coming into her own as a, you know, fiery, and of course, just because of the reddish hair, you know, high-flying wrestler. So I think it was a good, very good matchup, actually. Very impressive. Leva Bates in the veil. Of course, Leva Bates always a joy with her cosplaying gimmicks. And Nevaeh. Now, this, I remember at this show, there were some big fans of Nevaeh. These two little girls, I'm not sure what their age was, maybe 12, 13, something like that, maybe a bit younger, but they actually collected some streamers and were rolling them up because, of course, these Japanese, you know, paper streamers that you can throw before a match, many fans do this. They had gathered them together, and when Nevaeh came out, of course, she's playing a heel. You know, she comes out, you know, to booze and everything. These girls didn't care. They loved Nevaeh. They cheered for her, and she kind of blew them a kiss, kind of a sarcastic kiss. But nevertheless, I think it was a little bit of a moment they had. They connected, so I was happy for them. They just loved her, and they didn't care what anybody else thought. But they had their streamers ready when she was announced, and they threw. And so when she stands up and does her little pose when she's introduced, you see a red and a blue streamer fly past her just perfectly in the camera. So it was quite a moment. So that's the thing with wrestling. You can create a character that the fans are supposed to love. If the fans don't accept it, you know, you can't force them. And if they are supposed to hate someone, you can't force them. So it was just kind of a fun little thing. I don't think anyone held it against them because, you know, of course they are young, but of course Nevaeh, you know, as a wrestler, you know, she had this long history as a baby face, you know, with her tag team partner, Ashley Lane, who of course became Madison Rayne. I think Nevaeh actually became a much more interesting wrestler as a heel. Over time, you know, her physique changed, and she just, I just appreciate her a lot more. And seeing her through the eyes, of course, these little girls who idolized her, you know, as a hero, despite her being bad, it was just refreshing to see. But that's wrestling for you. So, moving on, Candice LeRae versus Nikki Storm. Now, of course, Candice LeRae, kind of these cute, you know, unassuming woman, and nevertheless with kind of a mean streak, kind of a little bit of a risque special move there, but having quite a good match with Nikki Storm. Of course, Nikki Storm with her long introductions, her, you know, musculature, you know, very very fit physique, and of course good witty banter on the microphone. Just a great all-around wrestler. I missed her in recent shows. Of course, Nikki Storm from Glasgow, Scotland. Yes, very good. So, I think a good matchup between both of them, because Candice LeRae, very talented wrestler. Of course, she's had to show out in a division, well, not a division, but in a promotion primarily male-focused. And so, of course, when there's only a few women on the roster, chances are they may play sort of the girlfriend, the valet, the kind of, you know, whatever sexy cheerleader kind of person, and be shoved into the background. But what she does is really has to up her game in terms of wrestling, so she can keep up with the men. And so I think she does a great job. Of course, here she is in a promotion where she's not, you know, one of only two women or something like that. But all female promotion. But she did a great job. So I was very impressed with Candice LeRae. And of course, Nikki Storm getting better and better each time I see her. So very impressive. Courtney Rush versus Veda Scott. Of course, I'd begun to criticize Courtney Rush for her character, feeling as if, you know, her past, you know, spunky, you know, heroic figure was much better than kind of this depressed, annoyed, you know, injured villain that she's becoming. But nevertheless, she, you know that she has skill, you know that she has personality. She's just kind of going through kind of a rough spot. And Veda Scott, of course, her time as in Ring of Honor and other places, I think she's been in Shine and a few other promotions, has really improved her overall wrestling skill, her you know, confidence on the mic, her overall personality. Of course, she is becoming kind of a conniving, backstabbing, you know, bad person. And so the two of them kind of going at it is interesting, to say the least. I wouldn't say this was the best match on the card by any means, but I do see them improving. Of course, Courtney Rush's character in the next set of volumes, I think, was much better, much improved from this outing, but it's not unwatchable, to say the least. And I can understand if she was going through a period of injury and recovery, she couldn't do as much. I feel bad anytime I hear that wrestlers are wrestling injured, you know, for real. It's not very safe, but nevertheless, they do what they can. It is a job. The show must go on and all that, but I kind of wish they'd take time off and come back at full strength. So there you go. And of course, some wrestlers, you know, like Cherry Bomb, when she was injured, she was still active on the sidelines, you know, just in a different role. So there you go. There are other things wrestlers can do, but I think that's a problem for athletes in general, is the pride, the desire to stay in the public eye, to stay in the stay on the front lines, as it were, despite, you know, injuries, health concerns, and so forth. Heidi Lovelace versus Aquino. Now, there was a promo that Heidi Lovelace did, and this was exactly the kind of psychology I've always been saying for Shimmer, is that these Joshi wrestlers come in from Japan with just this bravado and this reputation and glamour to say, you know, we're the best in the world and we're going to destroy everyone in our path, you know, who's not, you know, worthy of us. And of course, even the best, you know, Joshi performers still have a bit of a mean streak. You know, if you, once you push them and say, oh, you want to fight, huh? Well, I'll crush you and destroy you and laugh about it. Well, Heidi Lovelace puts herself out there and says, basically, you know, whether I win or not, this will prove, you know, the fact that I can go the distance with Aquino shows that I am of quality, that I have potential and strength and courage and so forth. And that's exactly what she does. Of course, Aquino, very powerful, very hard-edged, you know, female wrestler, almost a butch, a kind of a performer. Of course, she's had many different gimmicks over time, as many wrestlers have, but, you know, almost like a Power Ranger sort of hero figure, but nevertheless, very tough, almost like a schoolyard bully, like, let me challenge you, show me what you've got, you know, I'm better than you, and I can prove it with my skills. And, of course, Heidi Lovelace, you know, small, you know, unassuming wrestler, with her kind of, you know, punk rock ragdoll gimmick, really an underdog. And I think she really showed that she did have a great quality. So in spite of myself, I found myself rooting for Heidi Lovelace, despite, you know, me always being on the side of the Japanese wrestlers, simply because of their amazing pedigree and skill. Of course, Aquino, kind of a legend, as it goes, from a different generation of wrestler. But very good match, I would say, overall, and it went on for quite a while. But I think the fans really, really had a treat there. So, moving on. Jessica Havoc versus Vanessa Craven. Now, this had to happen. This reminded me much, but I think it was a superior match, to the, some time ago, TNA had a match between Awesome Kong and Jessica Havoc. Well, of course, two very large women. It would be like if, you know, Andre the Giant and the Big Show for fighting. And of course, when you think about the scale of these women, you know, a 6 foot or 6 foot one woman, maybe, you know, 250 pounds or 200 pounds, really doesn't look that large compared to a, you know, a 6 foot, 250 pound man. But compared to these other women wrestlers, they are giants, they are titans, they are massive, incredible, and not as if these are, you know, people that look like they're out of shape and couldn't do any damage, but just, you know, someone who could kick some butt, as they say. So this was a very brutal match. I think they fought a little bit slow, a little bit too slow, as if, I mean, they're not that big, and we're not talking about an 8 foot tall, you know, monster, but they really sold, you know, the power and the strength, the brutality. And of course, the two of them both, you know, a bit on the heelish side anyway. So it was entertaining, and you knew this was a matchup they couldn't afford to not do, to have these two biggest women currently on the roster to face one another. Of course, there have been other large women in the past. Of course, Amazing Kong, as I mentioned before, and some Joshi wrestlers that would later make an appearance in future volumes, which I will get to. And, you know, someone like Melanie Cruz. Of course, then you get tall wrestlers that are more slender, like Madison Eagles, but the two of them are certainly the biggest. And this was just a brutal, brawling, you know, match. And I think it ended up making Jessica Havoc a little bit sympathetic, you know, despite what was going on, you know, politically in the background, in her personal life and so forth. Nevertheless, in the terms of wrestling, you know, she was such a brutal bully, you know, a backstabbing, you know, demonic, you know, Nazi character, whatever you want to call it. She was a bad person, and yet the way she was treated in this match, I think, brought some sympathy to her, and you could see, you know, in the future that there would be a change, that she would become more of a fan favorite, more of a good guy, an anti-hero, if you will. So moving on, Sweet Soraya Knight and Mayumi Ozaki, of course, teaming up against Kana and Lufisto, and for a no disqualification match. Now, it was agreed that all of Mayumi Ozaki's matches would be no disqualification, and this may have had something to do with her, you know, state of injury. Of course, she is, you know, an older professional wrestler. She's been through a lot of hardcore matches over her career, death matches in Japan. But nevertheless, this match was very good in terms of, you know, the level of excitement due to the violence, the brawling. There was a very strange ending to it, though. A bit of a spoiler here is that Kana and Ozaki basically left the match at a certain point. They left, and Kana was not seen again, so I'm not sure what we're supposed to imagine happened. Did she just beat her so badly and left her for dead somewhere? Did she flee the building? What happened? They just kind of went upstairs, you know, punching and, you know, chains flying, and because there were weapons involved, and we don't know what happened. So I think that was a little strange. I'll have to watch the next two volumes, which I haven't seen yet, actually, because I was not there at the live show, and the digital versatile discs were not out at the time. Of course, now they've been out for a while. I've seen 71, but not 69 or 70 yet. And so I may be watching those in the next, certainly by next month, before Christmas, unless I get them for Christmas. But I would like to see, you know, what happened to Kana, because we know Kana goes to NXT and becomes Asuka. But what happened to her and Shimmer? Is she allowed to wrestle for Shimmer? Because lots of wrestlers from Shimmer have appeared in NXT and yet have been back, just kind of doing a one-off, you know, jobbing to some other enhancement talent, is what they call it, where a wrestler comes in and gets defeated by someone else to make that wrestler, that established wrestler, look better. But so apart from that oddity, I would say this was a great match. And what you'd expect from these characters, from Sweet Soraya, of course, such a bully, such a villain, such a nasty, mean, you know, wicked character. And yet, Mayumi Ozaki, you know, she meets her, and she likes her. This is the person that brings her joy because she's of a similar mind. Someone who just loves brutality and just cheating. Of course, they're not cheating because no disqualification, but anyway, not bad. And of course, Lufisto, you know, she has a hardcore fighting past, but nevertheless, she and Sweet Soraya, you know, I won't spoil the match, but just the disappearance of Kana, a little strange. Not really explained very well, I don't think. Moving on, Mia Yim versus Evie. Now this match, it was a little funny because someone in the crowd said something like, you know, let's hurry this match up so we can go get pizza. So I think it was very close to the end already, the end of the evening. And Mia Yim picked up on this and basically, you know, was trying to get Evie to submit to her submission move to give up, so that they could go eat pizza because he was getting hungry. And it was just kind of funny because this otherwise serious match, you know, just a little bit of jokes here and there. And there's some references to Frozen, which, you know, was a popular film, especially among young women at this time. I didn't quite understand all the references there, but nevertheless, wrestlers would do what they do. There's often on these shows there are references to WWE, and I think there's kind of an unspoken, you know, desire and dream that all these wrestlers want to go to WWE, you know, to appear on NXT and go to the main roster and the Divas and everything. And I think really the Shine promotion seems geared towards preparing all these wrestlers for future careers in WWE. And I'm not really sure how I feel about that. I may do a future video on the standards in women's wrestling of WWE and supposed Divas Revolution and all these things they're talking about. And yet the quality of Shimmer is so good most of the time that I feel that, you know, I just hope that we don't lose every wrestler and that they are forced to do, you know, kind of a dumbed down, you know, watered down style and appearance and everything and just become, you know, one of these generic TV wrestlers. But nevertheless, I mean, each wrestler has their own aspirations for career, their own desire for, you know, higher pay, and maybe fewer injuries, not having to do as many crazy moves, and maybe less travel. So there's so many things, so many factors go into it. But just from the perspective of a fan, you know, I like to see them succeed, but at the same time, I'll miss them if they're all gone, and appearing on television in these, you know, 2-minute matches to be defeated by, you know, some model turned wrestler. But there you go. So the WWE references, I'm not sure if it's fans trying to, you know, praise the WWE and kind of, you know, draw attention to the promotion and say, hey, look, hire these people on your show. Or what? I'm not really sure what goes on there. It goes through those fans' heads. Some of them are a little crazy, but it's fun. It's a good experience. I enjoyed myself overall the show. I would say, except for a couple matches where people were just kind of dead and not really interacting at all, overall it was a very fun experience. So no complaints about the show, really, except that I was late, and that was my own fault. Snafu. The tag team title match between uh, 3G, the Global Green Gangsters, against Tsukasa Fujimoto and Kaori Yoniyama. This was a great match, of course. Not quite as amazing overall as the Joshi versus non-Joshi, well, except for Tomoka, match on 67. But nevertheless, very good. Perhaps the standout match of the evening, or of this volume, I should say. Very good match. Of course, Kaori Yoniyama, maybe the senior wrestler of that group. Tsukasa Fujimoto, you know, much more younger, more you know, athletic and so forth. But it was a good combination, kind of a larger brawler, stocky, you know, fighter in Yoniyama. And then Fujimoto, you know, the kind of the slender, you know, high flyer. And so the two of them, and there were just some funny moments where Kelly Skater, of course, and Tomoka, they would get, they would basically, like, each team would pick, you know, the smaller person to beat up on. So Tomoka would get beaten up and double-teamed by the one team, and then Fujimoto would get beaten up and double-teamed on her team. And so it was this back-and-forth psychological warfare. Like, oh, you want to beat up my partner? I'm going to beat up your partner. What do you think about that? So just kind of this funny back-and-forth kind of thing. I suppose this wouldn't really work very well if it was four, grown men wrestling. But for some reason, when it's four women, it's just fun, and it's not the type of, annoying melodrama that you'd expect from a WWE kind of Total Divas, catfight. But there's just a kind of a psychological element that makes it an interesting story, even though, when you look at it, there's no setup, there's no background, just here's four people having a wrestling match. And yet they tell a story within it, so I think they did a good job here. And yeah, it really drew the fans in. Of course, lots of crazy moves, as usual. So, just, we expect nothing less. And we got it, a well-deserved, I think, match. So very good overall. And then, the Shimmer Championship. Four-way match. This was a ridiculous contest between Cheerleader Melissa, Madison Eagles, Athena, and Nicole Matthews. And now you might guess by the spoiler on the cover, spoilers, there's going to be a lot of spoilers here. The way this match ended was a shock, a bit of a shock, because at the time we didn't realize Nicole Matthews, of course, she'd been going up, rising up, always a heel. But having more and more competitive matches, and Portia Perez fading into the background, and of course later we learn Portia Perez was, planning her retirement, presumably due to injuries. And more Nicole Matthews was taking center stage. The Canadian Ninjas were not gone as a tag team, but Nicole Matthews really showing her quality and her goofy faces and her shrill, annoying voice. Just a very good heel and a great up-and-coming wrestler, very impressive. We all hated her, but we loved to see her. So anyway, she versus Athena, of course, who had a huge push and then kind of faded a little bit, possibly due to injuries, but still very, good wrestler. And of course, Madison Eagles, who had been gone because of injury again, coming back, almost as good as she'd ever been, with a little bit more comedy thrown in. People throwing streamers for her and making her happy, even though she, wanted to beat everyone up. So kind of a great in-between character. And then, of course, Cheerleader Melissa, who gets boos and cheers. She's always been kind of a heelish champion, a heelish babyface. Even when she's at the top of her game, she's just a little bit shady. But the fight, just the back and forth in this whole match. I mean, Nicole Matthews. At the end, she throws a fireball into the face of Madison Eagles. This has never been seen before in Shimmer. Of course, the flash paper, then the lighter, and you could smell burning hair and chemical smell in the arena. And of course, Madison Eagles really sold that fireball as, this burned my face off, kind of thing. I'm sure it singed her eyebrows and re-burned a little bit of her hair. I was worried about, well, the hairspray could have caught on fire and really been dangerous. It looked like actually it landed a bit on her chest and then up into her face, so she could have had burns, sensitive parts of the body, but I mean, she's okay. But at the time, she really made us believe that, she'd been really hurt, blinded, scorched by this fire. And of course, Nicole Matthews just kind of beside herself with glee, say, and she was still cowardly. She said, "Get this, piece of trash out of the ring, ruining my celebration." But she still kind of made her way quickly to the back to get out of there. And so we felt sympathy for Madison Eagles, despite the fact that she's a bad person, and she's going against another bad person. I mean, the best person in this match was Athena, who, of course, started out as a heel, and yet was so cheered by the fans that they forced her to become a babyface. But anyway, I think this is a great match overall. There were some great moments. There was just some ridiculous, over-the-top moments. They brought in, I think it was, yes, it was Bryce Remsburg, and he, of course, the classic ref bump, they say, he gets in the way of this incredible dropkick that makes him flip over. And I've seen Bryce Remsburg do some crazy moves. He's kind of an athletic little guy. I mean, he's a smaller man, but he does kind of flips and slides. And of course, many referees are actually very, active, very flexible, and fast moving. They have to be, but most of the time you don't notice them because the focus is on the wrestlers. But the referee is a big part of the match. The passing of the moves, the determining the level of excitement of the crowd, so many things. Of course, poor Andy Long, you know, kind of a large man compared to Remsburg. He, often gets booed for his bad calls. He kind of just stands there and watches, you know, cheating going on, and he doesn't put a stop to it. So Remsburg is taken out, and then Andy Long comes in, and he gets taken out too. Of course, the way he's taken out, he was kind of just crushed in the corner by, I think Nicole Matthews kind of smacked into him. But it was a little less believable because, of course, you get this man getting this massive drop kick and flipping completely over, and he's taken out. But then Andy Long, who is larger than most of the female wrestlers, just kind of getting pressed against the soft turnbuckles and then keeling over and being taken out just as long as the others, didn't quite make as much sense. But nevertheless, you could just—I guess you just have to imagine that he's, you know, he's a wimp. All these referees are, you know, not prepared to take punches and attacks of that kind. Of course, Bryce Remsburg, known for tackling people at various times, but nevertheless, so Andy Long is taken out, and so another referee has to come in, and then eventually we get Portia Perez interfering on behalf, of course, of Nicole Matthews. It was just funny to just see the escalation, the continual, you know, taking out of the referees. Oh, here's another referee. Oh, he got taken out too. Oh, was the first one going to come up? And what's happening? So just ridiculous. But the theater, the spectacle, that's what it's all about. That's what professional wrestling is that you accept all of these crazy things because of the show. And you believe that somehow it all makes sense. So I would say this is a great, great volume. I think overall the quality is slightly better than 67. So 67 was a great volume. I really liked it, but there were some matches that were just not as good as the others. They just kind of did not reach that high level of quality that Shimmer is known for. And some of that's because of the inexperience of the wrestlers and just trying, you know, last minute changes to the schedule, trying to figure it out. But I think overall, this is a better volume. And no, it's not perfect by any means, but a great way to end that Saturday. And I wish I could have seen Sunday's matches, Sunday's show, but I'll have to tell you later, you know, whether or not it measures up to those. Because 71 is just a whole different type of show. But I'll be reviewing that in due time. I really want to do some more video game reviews, and those should be coming up in the channel shortly. Of course, I have so many things, and I keep wanting to do a video and then getting interrupted by something else. So I apologize, but I hope you enjoyed this, and it's great to get back into reviewing, you know, Shimmer and other wrestling. Also, I've been following NXT with various performances by Shimmer wrestlers, you know, making little appearances here and there. Shazza McKenzie has appeared, Evie, some others. So I'll be covering that, of course, too, time permitting. But thank you for watching, and I'll wish you a happy Thanksgiving if you are in that part of the world. And of course, we have the Christmas season and other holidays coming up, so safe, happy Earth holidays and so forth. Anyway, that's it for now. So